So, wonderful to be here. I already had a great introduction from Sander, I believe. I hope you all already know something about security, but I also hope that you learn a lot from this session. So, something short about me. My hello world was in 1980. I've been in managing positions for a long time, mostly as a CIO. Currently, I work at a company that has no managers because they believe in true autonomy. And that's why I work there, because I think that's wonderful. Because yes, you have leading positions, but managing does something different. It takes away some of the space and autonomy. And that's where we think experts should be in the lead as a company. And that's something I'm really liking. So, Schuberg Phyllis, what is that for kind of company? It is an outsourcing company. We do IT outsourcing of mission-critical applications. So that means that we mostly have very big clients, and we only have like 20 clients with 300 people. So that gives something away about the size of the outsourcing. And when you outsource things that are so mission critical, security is of the essence, of course. It is always of the essence. But in these environments, mostly things like banking, energy providers, insurance, post office, those are all vital functions for a country as a whole, even. So you have to do that really good. That's what we're trying. And we're also succeeding in a way because this is a independent research of how well perceived we are, and we are way over there. This does not work. On the top. And we are there every year, so we really like that, where people say, you are so proactive, we even have an NPS of 98, which is 98% of customers is proactively saying you should work with us. So that's all about the company. More about security. So why focus on security? Why did I come into security? Because I always thought that security was kind of boring and draining, and I never really could stand the whole hour of listening to security experts, to be honest, because mostly it just did not land with me. It was not about code, it was not about IT, it was about some vague risks that I could not get my head around. I don't know if you recognize that. So it was not my hobby, actually. And that kind of changed at a certain moment. And I hope I can tell you why. Because we moved into Agile, and we already heard Sander talk about Agile, right? And with Agile, focus shifted to speed and nothing else. So it was like we do iteration after iteration, and it's always sprinting, indeed. Well, it should be a marathon, because sprinting is not sustainable for years and years and years, right? And every sprint, you do some concessions about how about your quality, about your security, and that's a shame, because every time you are accumulating risk, right? There's a lot of new technologies coming in, and we are starting to use them right away, we're starting adopting them right away, all trying to get up with the speed that the competitors are achieving, but at what risk? Also, there is a pop-up box. Also, we see that we live in a world of constant change. So where we used to deploy maybe once a year, once a quarter, we are now moving to a world where we deploy every day or multiple times per day. And in that way, we are introducing more and more risk every day because we have less time. I mean, when I started, for instance, at an insurance company, we were deploying 2 times per year. And every time we deployed, we did a pen test previous to that deployment. When we left, we did about 3-4 deployments per day. We could not do a pen test every time before we deployed, right? So you need to rethink the way you're going to add security. And we see a higher IT scope with higher liabilities also. So when you only do some customer-facing front-end applications, then the liability is limited. When you are introducing business processes that will reach the core of your systems, that will allow people to make big transactions in banking, for instance, then this security things becomes more important, right? And we see an increase in complexity. So we already heard talks about AI, about IoT, machine learning. There's a bunch of new languages coming in. And all these things are introducing new risks. For instance, in IoT, I believe that 50% of devices are still running on the default password. And that's what customers do, right? So we need to help them protect themselves, because they are not doing it for themselves. And we see a lot of autonomous teams. So where there used to be a central security department that took care of things with the expertise of security, that's now changed. If you want to be truly autonomous, you need to take care of security yourself. So the question is, are you? And we see a lot of changing roles. So in these autonomous teams, you are so small that you need to do a lot of things, because this one expert on infrastructure gets on a holiday sometimes, and somebody else steps in from within the team, somebody who did not have this 20 years of experience in infrastructure, or this 20 years of experience in testing, or whatever role you are adapting to make sure that you as a team go on and deliver value. So you're doing a lot of new roles, and maybe you're lacking behind on some of the expertise, because it comes at a cost. So if you look at the numbers in the end, the top 5 data breaches had their roots in application security. That's a stat of have I been pwned. And we see that a 38% increase of application layer attacks is happening right now. Security is a big thing. And only 46% of teams say they are confident about the level of security they are applying to their applications. So in the end, it all boils down to this. Software culture does not understand prevention. We are always focused on creation, on creativity. We're less focusing on control and prevention. It's just not in our nature. And you also have a leaflet, right, with a course. So it says something about cybersecurity. It's an optional module in school. Cybersecurity is optional. I don't think that really is optional. I think we need to change this metaphor. So in the end, I thought, what kind of security role play are we playing? Because 98% of companies have a CISO, a security officer who's responsible for delivering security. But are we really delivering security? Or is this more a role play? Is this more paper security, where we say, yes, we can deliver you a report which says we are safe, but are we confident that we are safe? And the answer in most of the environments where I ask this question is no. We are quite confident. We are not secure, but we don't have the time or the knowledge to actually apply security. And that's what this talk is about. How can you start raising your level of security in your team, not by a central expert team, but in your own team? So that's when I started to go security all in. That's the moment where I thought, okay, I need to know more about security to hope to be able to lead the way to this new environment. So let's see, how would you do that, security in an agile world? Because we're all in an agile world, right? Well, this is not what I like. this is mostly how it's done at companies. It's where the DevOps, well, they make all this shit and the security person cleans it up. That's not how it should be, because these people are always in a fight then together. Because these people want to deploy things, that's where they add value. And these people want to stop things, because they don't trust each other. And that's terrible, that's not the way you should work together. I really like this tweet. If you're doing DevOps without security, you're doing it wrong. It was never meant to run without security. At my company, some people even say that DevOps, that the S stands for secure, right? Just as HTTPS. But when we change it, I do not want it to be like this. I do not want to be the person who stops everything from being pushed out. Because we need to deliver value. That's why we exist. We're not existing to stop delivery of value, because that's not agile. Agile is uncovering better ways to deliver value. So stopping everything is not delivering. So we need to shift left on security, because the sooner we know that there's something wrong in security in our environment, the sooner we can change this and we can make sure that we're not stopped at the end where it hurts very much. We don't want that. So Ryan Shoup, who used to work at Google, he now works at WeWork, He says, I never once spoke with the security team at Google. Not because they weren't doing their job. It was exactly because they were doing their job. They encoded their expertise into self-service tools and libraries, and we just used them ourselves. So that's a very different metaphor, where security starts to be an enabler of value instead of a stopper or a blocker. And then let's just look at how this continuous security could work then. So I don't know if we know the definition of continuous delivery, which is a set of practices and principles aimed at building, testing, releasing software faster, more frequently. They help to reduce the cost, time, and risk of delivering changes, and ultimately value, by allowing for more incremental changes in production. There turned out to be no definition of continuous security. So I thought I'd just write one, inspired by this one. So continuous security would still be a set of practices and principles in software engineering aimed at designing, developing, testing, and running software more securely. They help to reduce the time, cost, and risk of delivering integrity, availability, and confidentiality, because security is all three. It's not only making sure that data is not exposed to anybody, but also that it is available to those who want to use it, and that you know that you can use it in with full integrity, that you can trust the data that's there. It's all three. To applications in production. And continuous delivery is essential. Continuous security is essential for continuous delivery. You can't do the continuous delivery if you do not take care of security in an agile way, because in the end, it will hurt too much. And then we can just start, because if you don't know how to do this yet, yeah, just start, because while you are doing it, you are learning. And that will grow very fast in my experience, because about 2 years ago, I knew nothing about security, to be honest. Well, about the paper security and something about the ISO standards and stuff like that, but not about how to really practically build security into your applications. And if you start doing this, you will find out that you learn pretty quickly, that you will develop an expertise pretty quickly. So I hope you will join me. So I've created this DevSecOps model, and it consists of four steps. It's something about secure coding, defensible infrastructure, a supporting way of working, and situational awareness. So we're going to start with some secure coding. And I think there's a lot of developers here, so I hope that this resonates, right? Okay. If you want to do this in a continuous delivery world, in an agile world, you need to automate everything. So we're not going to check on reports every day, because that's the boring stuff. If you build security in, if you're automatically protected against a lot of vulnerabilities, that's the way that it's sustainable, because you can check that every time you commit code, instead of once every half year or something, because then a half year you're exposed to a lot of risk. That's not what you want. So we're going to integrate everything into our pipelines. And there's a lot of stuff already out there. So there's a bunch of steps. The first one is that you can introduce a SAST. A SAST is a static analysis security tool. And there's a lot of tools available. If you look at OWASP, if you go to this link, you will see that there's like 40 tools available. And you can just install one and use one. A lot of them are free. There is no budgetary reason not to do this, because a lot of them just come freely out of the box. We are using SonarQube. We are using it at present company. We also use SonarQube at a previous company. And you can just go to the configuration of SonarQube and put on the security rules, because they are not by default on, strangely enough. The benefits of a SAST, allows you to find problems very soon, because you don't need to run your application already. You can just look at the code. So you can get instant feedback the moment you write a line of code. It's very fast, and it's very precise, because it will tell you exactly what line of code is not okay. And that's also good. But it leaves a lot of things out of scope. So it can look at the code. It can look at the repositories. But what it can't do is look at the real risks of a running instance. That's different. So it has a limited scope. It has some false positives and false negatives. So what you need to do is every time you have a false positive or a false negative, is you need to register that as a false positive or a false negative. So that the next time you run it, it won't pop up again. Because otherwise you get like thousands of warnings and people start ignoring them, right? Because you don't have time to look through thousands of warnings. Next up is a DAST, which is a dynamic application security testing tool. This runs against the running instance of your application. We are using Nessus, Sentinel, and Zep at different customer teams, so we're not using one for the whole company. It's basically a pricing thing because Zep is free. It's one of the OWASP flagship projects. The other ones are paid and they have a very different margin, but also a different reliability. So they test the application at runtime. It's a very realistic view. It will really test the same thing that a hacker will use when they are trying to breach your application. But it's more complex. When you have findings, it's difficult to track where did these findings get introduced, because it checks against the running instance, right? And it's late feedback. So you don't get it while you're writing code, you get it afterwards, after a commit. So that is more costly. So you need to combine both in order to be safe. If you want to know what to choose, this is just a simple tip. There's the OWASP benchmark project. And it will tell you about all the tools that you can use and how well they are doing, because the red line is the guessing line. If you randomly guess if a line of code is vulnerable, it will be accurate in a certain percentage. You need to be at least better, right? So this one will tell you how good they are and how their performance is. The OWASP benchmark project is only available for Java. So that's a downside, because I think that's getting less and less used, right? So next up, you need to also do dependency checks. So dependency checks will say something about you are including a lot of third-party libraries. And these people are also introducing mistakes and vulnerabilities, right? So, but you don't know them because it's an external company or it's an external group of people or community. So you need to know what vulnerabilities there are. And these companies, they will register their vulnerabilities in a central vulnerability database. And once it's registered, all hackers know about the vulnerability. That's the downside. You know, but the hackers know too. So you need to fix it, because it's also exposed from that moment on. So once you know that there are libraries that have vulnerabilities, or there are third-party tools that have vulnerabilities, you need to be able to know that and patch that in time. And that's where the dependency checker comes in. We use JFrog X-Ray, but alternatives are Sonatype, OWASP Dependency Checker, and SAML. What they do is they just run your repositories, they see what kind of third parties you're using, and they check that against the database with all the vulnerabilities. So they will report which vulnerabilities are in there, how important are they, because they get a risk rating, so you know how soon you have to patch this. Then the other downside is you need to also be able to patch that through a pipeline that runs quite fast. Because if it takes you like half a year to patch something, then knowing it instantly has little value. So you need to be able to roll it out quite quickly, right? So we run the dependency checker. We started running it in the pipeline, but later on we started to realize that that does not really make sense, because third parties don't change by your own commit. They change by other people's commit, right? So you need to run this constantly. You need to install it as kind of a monitoring on your system. If you run it every 7 days, then you only need to have a very small a JSON file from the National Vulnerability Database, because every 7 days there's a new file updated, and you don't have to do a whole new install. So it will save you a lot of time. So run it at least every 7 days. So how it looks, we started running it. We had about 550 vulnerabilities when we first put it on, because we did not have this kind of a tool. So that's terrible, because it was a new code base. We did a greenfield project with a lot of microservices, and after a year we had already had 550 vulnerabilities. The upside is, a day later we only had 17 left. So it goes quite quickly. So just start doing it. You also need to do some licensing threat assessment. This is quite new for most people. If you're including a lot of third-party libraries, these third parties have a certain license. And there is something called viral licensing. And that says, if you include a single line of code of that third-party library, you are obliged to make your project open source. Most of the customers don't like that. If you include one of the third parties and you are suddenly exposed to having to run your whole project open source, that's a bad thing. That's why it's called viral licensing. This will check that you are not, by accident, including one of those tools. So you need to make sure that you don't, because it's a big obligation. And we also run a thing that's called evil user stories. Sometimes it's called malicious user stories. And these evil user stories are something like this. As a malicious hacker, I want to gain access to all repositories so that I can look for vulnerabilities and secrets and destroy their entire business. This is something a hacker wants. So you can implement a script, and you can check if your solution is not vulnerable against this. So for instance, we had an exposure where some of the repositories were put on public, which should have been on private. And this evil user story now checks every day if there is no repository by accident put on public. So you can just write them, and they need to be red to be green, right? So next up, defensible infrastructure. So you need to also be sure that your infrastructure is safe. And that used to be the thing that the system administrators did somewhere in the basement. You always put them on the first floor or something. But right now, we are running DevOps teams, right? So we need to take care of the infrastructure ourselves. And our team, for instance, is moving to Azure. So we're taking care of everything ourselves. And a lot of companies are also running on AWS, right? So when you start adopting infrastructure into your team, you also need to know something about that. Yeah, that's the right truth. So first of all, configuration is code. So never ever log into your instance and do your configuration there with a configuration management tool, because I think about 44% of all vulnerabilities in the infrastructure is introduced through the configuration, because you don't want to do anything manual. Then the whole network is set up properly, but then you introduce just a simple threat by doing some manual configuration. You don't want to do that. If you are going to infrastructure as code, you can test your configuration. And you need to, because it's one of the most important zones of your defense. And then go one step beyond, go towards an immutable infrastructure. You should anyway, because that's more scalable. Why should you go to an immutable infrastructure? Well, one of the main benefits of using containers, especially in microservice-based applications, is they allow you to apply this least privilege principle. Why should you still have an admin account on a production server if you are deploying your infrastructure as code through automation? Having no admin account on production increases safety by crazy numbers, because this is what hackers are always aiming for, trying to find the route through the admin account, right? That's the way that you hack. So if you can block this by not having an admin account, that's wonderful. You should. A bit broader, you can go for an immutable infrastructure mindset, where patches are code changes and they follow the pipeline. So you test them against all your regression tests, all your test automation, to make sure that you're not, through a patch, introducing some kind of regression or security vulnerability. And you can also use, this one is a nice one, systematic workload reprovisioning. So if you have immutability and you have automatically, you can scale up or down on your infrastructure, how cool is it that you can just destroy your workload and spin up a new one? Because if a hacker had access, he's thrown out again and again and again and again. So you do this with random intervals. And it's really difficult to persist if you're constantly thrown out of the instance. So if you even have access, then you need to start all over again. You can also scan your infrastructure scripts against the security policy. I'll come back to that later. You can apply least privilege principles, I already explained this, and apply pervasive visibility. And I will also come back to this a bit later. So testing your infrastructure. This is Matthijs, he's from our team. He runs the seal of approval from the security team, which is a big stuffed seal. And why did he win this? He applied a very cool tool where he said, we have these CIS best practices, Center of Internet Security. And these best practices, they tell you all about how your system should be hardened. So how there should not be an admin account, or how there should not be, or how there should be encryption, for instance, or about the patch level that you need to have. So there's a lot of best practices, and you need to follow them. And that's a lot of work by hand, right? And it's very hard to keep track. Am I doing the right thing? So you also need to automate this. What he did is, in the pipeline, he introduced a check against this CIS best practice. And it will report you all of the deviations. And then if there is a deviation, you can look at it. And sometimes the deviation should be there because, well, in your context, you just need to. Sometimes there's a reason, right? Because security is not black and white. So in that case, you can register the deviation and you can send a pull request to the security team and say, I want a deviation for this reason. They accept the pull request. So there's a four eyes principle. And then the deviation is not triggered anymore by the test. So every time you run a new instance, you're sure, you're absolutely secure that it follows all the best practices of the Center of Internet Security. That's what you want. And it's also fully auditable. So every deviation is registered. And we also have a CDN, which is a very strong gatekeeper. This is again at the World Center. a CDN, a content delivery network, that will allow you to have a baseline of protection against SQL injections, cross-site scripting, DDoS attacks, because they are centers of expertise which will help you block those attacks. Because you will always go through the CDN towards your application. So if you're not sure that you can handle with this yourself, be sure to introduce one of those tools into your landscape. And then we have a SIEM. So it will log all of the transactions that's being applied to your environment, and it will give you reports like this. So there is a IP address, a name, country, the reason, so there's a SQL injection attack, and then a suggestion. So sometimes they're just blocked. For instance, here there are 701 requests blocked. And sometimes we need some input. So for instance, SQL injections from Tor anonymizing services, we want to block them by default. There's no reason to come to a bank because my client is a bank through a Tor anonymous network. So next up, you have to have a supporting way of working. So there's a bunch of things. If you want to deliver secure coding and a defensible infrastructure, then there are things that are enabling you to do this. So first off, have some security champions. So for instance, I'm always hoping, Sander also used an example with his children, right? But I'm always hoping when I put bags on the staircase that my kids bring them up. But because everybody is responsible, nobody is doing it, and the bags just pile up at the bottom of the staircase. So having somebody solely responsible to do something helps you to achieve it. You can't be responsible with everybody because then nobody is responsible. Having security champions actually says this is the one person who is most responsible for doing security in the team. That does not mean that he or she is doing it on his or her own, but it does mean that this person keeps the overview, and that's a valuable position. So how we are doing this, we have SEC leads and SEC buddies. So this is the security team. They're a centralized core expertise team, and in every customer team we have, every customer team is autonomous, we have a SEC lead. And these people pair up. So the SEC lead is responsible for delivering security, and they can always go to the security team for some advice or some expertise. So make sure that you have a way of organizing security in your team. This one person who is most responsible for doing security, and that will lead the way for the rest. You also, and this is at the previous company, so this is the SEC team, they all dressed in black because they were doing some hacking, I guess. And you need to make sure that you don't eliminate all risk. So security needs to be balanced, just like all the other stories you're delivering. So you can't have an 100% customer experience, for example. You make choices there. And the same thing applies to security. So you need to prioritize all the things you want to do there. So this one really bothered me, for instance. This came from a penetration test of the accountant from our bank, and that said, phone number is in plain text, and it should not be, because you can do shoulder surfing. So somebody can read off your screen what your phone number is. So you should have all these asterisks instead of the number and only leave the last two numbers open, right? But this was in an application where you log in as a banking customer, where you can see your checking account balance, where you can see about 20 other personal data pieces. And yes, there was also a phone number. So in this context, it makes no sense anonymizing this phone number, because we're already exposing like 80 pieces of information. So look at the context and then think about, is this a finding? So we did not remediate this. We said, this is nonsense. Get it out. And they did, in the end. So make sure that you align security and business value. We don't want toilets to look like this. So there is functional value and there is security. And these two need to balance up with each other. You can't only go for security. And what we also did, we experienced that doing security up front is really helpful for us. So whenever we do an epic, which is a bigger story that gets drained down in little stories, we already think about, okay, let's do a quick assessment of what data is going in, what kind of security measures should we take in this environment. So this is a longer list, this is just a preview, but it says something about, okay, what kind of data is it? What kind of environment are we expecting? What kind of security measures should we apply here? So if you have a quick checklist, you can make sure that you don't miss out on what you should do in that point. And we also found it was very helpful to just identify and remove and really start small. So if you take on all these tools, then your pipelines will be red for years. So that's not the way you want to work. You need to really start small. So start applying one of those tools. And then say, for instance, there's a category of vulnerabilities. Let's fix that category first. Talk about it. Give people some context. Don't try to get it all green right away, because that's way too much work. So what we did, for instance, we said, okay, we've enabled these 100 security rules in SonarQube, and then we just send the top 10 screw-ups to the team. Like, these are the things that we really need to take care of. And then these findings were solved, and then we did it again a month later. So get into kind of a flow of improving and raising awareness on this point. So instance, we also did, Dominic enabled the dependency check. And we had hundreds of vulnerabilities. We solved them within a day with critical upgrades, and we removed a lot of obsolete dependencies, which raised our security level a lot in just one day work. Dominic also ran Dockerbench. So if you're running containers on Docker, you can run Dockerbench. And then we found that privileges were too high, so we corrected them, which also raised security. There's a lot of checks that you can do and that you can take baby steps in within a week. And another one, Michiel in this case, he set up a learning platform in Webcode where people could log in and learn something about security themselves and just test it with running code. Next up, you need to adapt to your context, because all these tools deliver a standard solution, but you are not standard. Your code base is your code base. And that means that you need to make sure that your rules are right for your setting. So all these false positives, false negatives, make sure that you register them as deviations. Get a tool that really applies to your security setting. So learn first, adapt before you break the build. Breaking the build right away is annoying. You have to still deliver value. And you were at risk before, so keep doing what you did and just make gradual changes. Adapt to your context. We also use this one, the Application Security Verification Standard, which is also one of the OWASP flagship projects. It has like 80 pages of recommendations how you should do security. 80 pages is something that nobody can fit into their minds anymore, because it's tables and tables of rules. Nobody can memorize this. Nobody can even read this without falling asleep. So you need to adapt this. What we did is we went through all these rules and we removed all the rules that were not relevant in our setting because we already had a SUST, we already had a DUST, we already had some other security scannings. And these scanners were already taking care of those rules, so we don't need to bother the developers again with these rules. So we removed all those rules, and we also removed rules that were just not relevant in our setting. So, for instance, they were only applicable on mobile, while we were not doing mobile. So, in the end, we ended up with two pages. And two pages was something that we could give to people, and they could memorize this, or they could at least use that as a checklist in their peer reviews. So right now, we're running a checklist of two pages, and people are checking those pieces of information. So, and be sure, if you have all these warnings, that you also fix your vulnerabilities. Because that's something we sometimes forget. We get focused on installing more tools. But if you don't clean up, it has no value, right? So make sure that you do this. Make also sure that you can detect your changes. Because every time there's a change, there's a risk of a vulnerability. So you need to run all your automation. If you are not able to see, to detect a change in your environment, you don't know when to run your automation. Treat security tests as source code. So make sure you put them under version control. You can do a rollback. Because security tooling is just as important, or security rules are just as important as your code base. So last one, and I will be very quickly, is the DevSecOps model. Is the situational awareness. So you have to also train for the basics. Why? Because we can automate a lot of security. We can automate all the scans, and we should. Because you can also, in the dark web, just buy one of the scripts, and it would be really stupid if your application is vulnerable against a ready-to-go script that you can just buy on the dark web somewhere. You don't want a vulnerability like that in your landscape. So all these automation tools will help you to not be vulnerable against the obvious. But then, there's also logical flaws. So for instance, we have a lot of RESTful interfaces with JSON protocols right now. And that means that there are a lot of consumers. And that sometimes if somebody adds a little field to an API, it might be that one of the consumers is now exposing a piece of data that it should not. That's a logical flaw. That's something in microservices we did not necessarily design for. So make sure that you also have awareness in the team. You can't automate it all. There are still logical flaws. You can still make mistakes. Infrastructure alone won't keep you safe. Coding alone won't keep you safe. There are still people. And people have the horrible thing of giving away their data. They are still the weakest link. So 10.6% of passwords is one of the top 20 passwords still today. A lot of people do just something on the keyboard that runs from left to right. If you look at brute force times for passwords, it's crazy. It's like if you have 8 digits, it was 115 days. But right now, it's only 5 days. And 9 digits was 20 years. It's now only 10 days. So the safety of the amount of characters is also declining. So you need to go to pass sentences. You type them in more quickly. And they're also easy to memorize. But they're very hard to break because they consist of 20 characters easily. So be sure that you also give your security experience to customers that they can use to actually make sure that they keep themselves safe. We always start with security bootcamps. Whenever you onboard a team, you get a bootcamp first. And you also have to make sure that you are thinking about what am I giving away. So for instance, this is an application to sell weed online. If you sell weed, hash, marijuana, online, that's a very bad plan to begin with. Period. You should not do that. Why not? Not because it's illegal. I mean, in my experience, people should do what they want. But of course, the police hacked into this system. Of course, they arrested everybody who bought or sold weed. It is crazy to think that you can defend yourself against something like this. Don't take risks that you should not take in any way, because it's just stupid. We did another thing that's hack yourself first or two. So we trained a lot of people to do a certified hacker course. And then every month we do a day of pen testing, which is kind of a security chaos engineering. Make rare events regular. If you hack each other every month, then you raise awareness in all the teams. and that's a great thing. I'm going to skip this one. So thinking of think as an offender, that will show you the real threats, because we always think from defense. You need to really change this. Last thing, we also do some red teaming. So we hired a company to try and hack us through social engineering, and they give a cake if you are not hackable. So we all ate cake, and then the cake came in, and this one person immediately put on a Slack message like, "Did you check the cake for hard and sharp objects before bringing it inside?" And that says something about the security awareness in our teams, I guess. But there was an upside. But then a month later, there was another internal red teaming event. And these were really cheesy posters on April Fool's Day, which should have given it away, right? There still was a bunch of people who used the QR code, which was not safe. And then on the same day, they did a questionnaire, which came from the inside, and all people trusted it. So 25 people gave away their credentials to the corporate system. So what it shows is that you lower your fences if it's from a trusted resource. So always be aware, and these kind of events will help train the company to be safe. So this is just a wrap-up of all the things that you can take care of. These are the slides. This is my LinkedIn page, so if you want to read it in a slower tempo, that's okay. Thank you for bearing with me.